Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Eric Walker, and welcome to this edition of Revealing Prophecy. Each week we connect the dots of the news from around the globe with biblical prophecy and talk about what was, what is, and what is to come. The monologue is our original work, and all other articles are used giving credit to their respective sources. We invite you to visit ignitinganation.com for a full roster of daily interviews, and we encourage you to sign up for our newsletter and YouTube channel so you never have to miss out on any special offers or events. Here's a quick look at what we will be covering on today's show. I'll be giving my opening monologue, followed by a story from Gatestone Institute, Iran to have the nuclear bomb in a few months, From the AP News, the Attorney General Netanyahu not required to resign. From JNS, Iran is planning attacks on Israel, Netanyahu. And honestreporting.com gives us a summary of the charges against Benjamin Netanyahu and an explanation. As we study prophecy and we look at the Bible, if you were to look at a place in the bookstore or in the library where you might find the Bible, it would be in the prophecy section. In the Bible, there's approximately 2,500 prophecies, of which around 2,000 have already been fulfilled exactly as God described them. Given that the Bible proves so reliable a document, there's every reason to expect that the remaining 500 prophecies, those slated for the time of the end, also will be fulfilled to the last letter. Who can afford to ignore these coming events, much less miss out on the immeasurable blessings offered to anyone and everyone who submits to the control of the Bible's author, God himself? Would a reasonable person take lightly God's warning of judgment for those who reject what they know to be true about Jesus and the Bible, or who reject Jesus' claim on their lives? And now for my opening remarks. Last week, I was interviewing Stephen Strang, head of Charisma Media, about his soon-to-be-released new book, God, Trump, and the 2020 Election. In that interview, we discussed many of the pros and many of the concerns we both shared about the president. As I reviewed the interview and the book, I felt we took a balanced, albeit pro-Trump, view. During that interview, we spent a great deal of time expressing concern over the potential for the body of believers to not get out and vote. In our analysis of the president, the subject of the president's tweets came up. Both Steve Strang and I agreed that we wish that the president was less engaged in tweeting and more focused on matters of state. As the discussion continued, we began to take a candid look at how Jesus took on the establishment and the power brokers, the Pharisees. The interview lasted about 55 minutes, and a week later, Right Wing Watch released a headline that says, Eric Walker, Trump is a modern-day prophet taking on the Pharisees just like Jesus. They actually took a 1-minute-and-38-second clip out of the 55-minute interview and transcribed it where I'm quoted as a part of the very balanced narrative as saying, and I quote, during a recent broadcast of his Revealing the Truth program, Messianic Rabbi Eric Walker of Igniting a Nation Ministries declared that Donald Trump is a modern-day prophet who has a lot in common with Jesus Christ. And also in quotes, if you were to take the gospel message, this is what I said, and break it down to some of the things that Jesus said and put them in a tweet, there are some things that Jesus said that would really absolutely send people over the edge, no different than Donald Trump standing up against the swamp, standing up against the establishment, and making these same statements. I went on to say it's really no different than 2,000 years ago when Jesus was taking on the Pharisees and the establishment. It parallels it in the exact same way. The article says Walker said that the Democrats today are the modern-day Pharisees, and Trump, in his own way, is a modern-day prophet, one who is willing to call sin, sin, call evil, evil, call wicked, wicked, and this is something that has upset people in power for over 2,000 years. Yes, when you cut out the context and the narrative before and after that statement was made, you might come away believing that I was declaring Donald Trump as a modern-day prophet. If you see the words in his own way, you see that it's a simile, a metaphor, a comparison, but it's certainly not a declaration. So you might come away believing that I was declaring him as a modern-day prophet. And then the emails began, and the most vocal were from the Mormons, the Church of the Latter-day Saints. These emails were so filled with hate and malice that I was told in no uncertain terms that I was going to hell from my statements, and that unless I issue a public retraction of referring to Donald Trump in any way on the prophetic spectrum, I will burn for eternity for blaspheming the teachings of Joseph Smith. Furthermore, these individuals stated that they've been ordained by God through Russell M. Nelson, who has been the president of the LDS since January 14th of 2018. The Latter-day Saints consider the church's president to be God's spokesman to the entire world and the highest priesthood authority on earth, with the exclusive right to receive revelations from God on behalf of the entire church or the entire world. The writers went on to say that they had been ordained as priests in the order of Melchizedek, and that I was now made known to the entire Church of the Latter-day Saints and under official condemnation. Whoa! Here I thought that the fatwa that I had been told of that would cost me my life if I went into certain Muslim countries was serious, but this is obviously a much more grievous offense than making any comments about Muhammad. I had no idea that these clean-cut young men going door-to-door wielded such amazing power to determine life and death and declare me to be under indictment by their church. I had no idea that there were around 15 million Latter-day Saints, as they refer to themselves now instead of Mormon. As a Jewish believer, I readily admit that I may have made no attempt to dig into the doctrinal and theological positions of denominational Christianity. I am woefully ignorant of the associated practices, rules, and regulations that distinguish one denomination from another. To be quite candid, it's just too confusing when you have people praying to Jesus and his mother and praying to saints. Then you have the body divided by baptismal practices and gifts of the Spirit, and which part of the Bible is optional, or if you just throw out the first half. According to the World Christian Encyclopedia, published by Oxford University Press, world Christianity consists of six major ecclesiastico-cultural blocks divided into 300 major ecclesiastical traditions composed of over 33,000 distinct denominations in 238 countries, according to Volume 1, page 16. So according to the World Christian Encyclopedia, the 33,000 figure represents world Christianity. Now, unless a Catholic wants to suppose that world Christianity means Protestantism, the number would have to be something less. 33,000, according to the source from which the number comes, means the whole of Christianity, not Protestantism specifically. The World Christian Encyclopedia then goes on to break down world Christianity into the following broad categories. Independents, 22,000 denominations. Protestants, 9,000 denominations. Marginals, 1,600 denominations. Orthodox, 781 denominations. Catholics, 242 denominations. And Anglicans, 168 denominations. That's 33,791 denominations of Christianity. Now you can see why I decided when I came to faith at age 44 that I would focus my attention on learning the scriptures and not man's practices. Imagine my utter confusion when I read Ephesians 4:4-6. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of us all, who is above all and through all and in all. when did that change and why didn't anybody tell me? Imagine my confusion, or even more so, imagine the confusion of every Jewish person who reads of the infighting among the denominations. And then, if that's not enough, the infighting inside the denominations. Is no one aware that the world is watching this tragic comedy unfold where God and Jesus are not being edified, but man is at war against other men as to what role women should play in the church? That's a huge stumbling block for a matriarchal people like my people, the Jews. Or the debate over what is sin or what is acceptable human behavior. Is the Bible not clear on these matters that the world has to have conferences and debates about the same folly that our own government is engaged in? It's embarrassing to say the least, in trying to engage in Jewish apologetics, where the very behavior of any of the 39,000 denominations of Christianity is enough to turn even the most devout believer away from what we call the church today. The fact that we publicize the decline and then elevate the fastest growing church as if that is what this is all about. Have we become so egotistical about our church that we've forgotten all about the Great Commission and living a Christ-like life? How is it that horror movies and pornography and every form of debauchery is being condoned, and the response is, well, we're all in a fallen world? Well, certainly that is true, but we were called to be set apart, and even though all of us are laced with temptation and many succumb to it, God used David and his contrite heart as an example as to how we can stumble, yet by his grace we can stand and become people after God's own heart. If I, as a Jewish believer, am confused as to what it means to be a Christian, because there's no one clear definition that all Christians adhere to, then why are we surprised that the message isn't getting out and people are turning away from the church? And by what grace, love, and mercy do 15 million people show me by condemning me to hell for a soundbite published by a radical right-wing website? Since Jesus is not coming back until the Jews call for his return, don't you think we should act more loving and tolerant and forgiving than the rest of the non-believing world? Or has the body of Christ forgotten Paul's admonition, Romans 11, where he writes, I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? Certainly not. But through their fall to provoke them to jealousy, salvation has come to the Gentiles. Now, if their fall is riches for the world and their failure riches for the Gentiles, how much more their fullness? For I speak to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I am an apostle to the Gentiles. I magnify my ministry, if by any means I may provoke to jealousy those who are my flesh and save some of them. For if their being cast away is the reconciling of the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? For if the first fruits is holy, the lump is also holy. And if the root is holy, so are the branches. And if some of the branches were broken off, and you, being a wild olive branch, were grafted in among them, and with them became a partaker of the root and fatness of the olive tree, do not boast against the branches. But if you do boast, remember that you do not support the root, but the root supports you. You will say then, branches were broken off, that I might be grafted in. Well said. Because of unbelief they were broken off, and you stand by faith. Do not be haughty, but fear. For if God did not spare the natural branches, he may not spare you either. Therefore consider the goodness and severity of God on those who fell. Severity, but toward you goodness, if you continue in his goodness. Otherwise, you also will be cut off. And if they also, if they do not continue in unbelief, will be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again. For if you are cut out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and were grafted contrary to nature into a cultivated olive tree, how much more will these who are natural branches be grafted into their own olive tree? For I do not desire, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own opinion, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And so all of Israel will be saved, as it is written, the deliverer will come out of Zion, and he will turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. Concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sake, but concerning the election, they are beloved for the sake of the fathers. For the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable. For as you were once disobedient to God, yet have now obtained mercy through their disobedience, even so these also have now been disobedient, that through the mercy shown you, they also may obtain mercy. For God has committed them all to disobedience, that he might have mercy on all. As we approach Thanksgiving and Christmas, maybe it's time to rethink the message and the messenger. The message has not changed. Jesus died for our sins. Shouldn't that mean something more than just I get my sins forgiven and receive eternal life? We are all called to be his messengers. Are we too busy fighting with each other over doctrine that we have forgotten that we're supposed to be ambassadors of heaven? Are we really presenting something more attractive than what the world has to offer? God himself says he did not send his son to condemn the world, but to save the world. If God did not send Jesus to condemn the world, then how is it that believers are condemning each other? And then that opens the door to who's a believer, and we're back to the beginning as to what I don't understand about Christianity. I'm a believer in Jesus as the promised Jewish Messiah. I am still Jewish and did not convert to anything. My body has been circumcised, but now my heart has also been. My heart of stone has been replaced with the heart of flesh. I try daily to do a better job of being kinder, more loving, more considerate, more understanding. I have my good days and some not so good, but what is the face of Christianity to the world? We are the messengers. And if we're going to be just as divisive and vindictive and condemning as the rest of the non-believing world, then what value is there in being a believer? Are we becoming so self-centered that we forgot the Great Commission was to go out and make disciples of the world? One gospel, one Jesus, one Holy Spirit, one God. We have so much to be thankful for, and all we seem to do is argue over the things that divide us, as opposed to the uniting through the shed blood of Messiah. If the gospel was given to the Gentiles to provoke Israel to jealousy, isn't it time we gave them something to be jealous of? What if we just started showing a little love to one another and were a reflection of the unmerited love poured out on us? To those who wrote me and condemned me to hell, my Father says you are wrong. And we will pray for you and the other 5.5 billion others around the world that do not know the truth of God's word. The larger question is, do you know the truth of God's word? My prayer for you and all of those around the world is that you would know the truth. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. In verse 18, it says, he who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. But he who does the truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be clearly seen that they have been done in God. Our calling to be set apart. Not set apart to fight with each other, but to reconcile man to God and become ambassadors of heaven, bringing a message of love, of inclusion, not exclusion. Not a set of legalism and rules and regulations to abide by, but to walk in love, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. from all of us here at Igniting a Nation, we wish you a light-filled and joyful Thanksgiving, and we are eternally thankful for you. And that, my friends, is today's monologue. Now for the rest of our stories. Iran to have the nuclear bomb in a few months. The Iranian government is shortening its nuclear breakout time, the amount of time required to produce enough weapons-grade uranium for a single nuclear weapon. Tehran has accomplished this through several steps in the last few months. Iran's government first increased its enriched uranium stockpile beyond the 300-kilogram limit. It enriched uranium to levels beyond the cap of 3.67% and then activated 20 IR-4 and 20 IR-6 advanced centrifuges. The Iranian leaders even boasted that their government is now exploring new uranium enrichment programs and producing centrifuges. Most recently, the head of the Atomic Energy Organization of Iran, Ali Akbar Salehi, declared that Iran has an adequate supply of 20% enriched uranium. Right now, we have enough 20% uranium, he told the Iranian Students News Agency, but we can produce more as needed. He added that the country is resuming uranium enrichment at a far higher level at the Fordow nuclear facility, an underground uranium enrichment facility, which is reportedly located on one of the bases of the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps, injecting uranium gas into centrifuges and operating 60 IR-6 advanced centrifuges. This marks a dangerous phase in Iran's nuclear defiance. Tehran is now using a kind of prototype centrifuge that enriches uranium almost 50 times faster. Iran's nuclear breakout time in 2015 was estimated less than 1 year. Tehran has advanced its nuclear program since then. In an interview with Iran's state-owned Channel 2, Salehi admitted that the nuclear deal initiated by then-U.S. President Barack Obama not only failed to restrict Iran's nuclear program, it actually helped Iran to advance its nuclear program through the flow of funds thanks to the lifting of sanctions. If we have to go back and withdraw from the nuclear deal, he stated, we certainly do not go back to where we were before. We will be standing in a much, much higher position. Although Iran is a party to the Non-Proliferation Treaty, it refuses to allow the International Atomic Energy Agency to inspect its sites. The IAEA is also not allowed to inspect or monitor Iran's military sites where nuclear activities are most likely being carried out. Among the many concessions that the Obama administration granted to the Iranian government, one was accepting the Iranian leader's demand that military sites would be out of the IAEA's reach. Because of this surrender at various high-profile sites, such as the Parchin military complex located southeast of Tehran, the regime has been free to engage in nuclear activities without the risk of inspection. The Iranian leaders keep claiming that their nuclear activities are solely for peaceful purposes. This claim is bogus. If the Islamic Republic is advancing its nuclear program for peaceful purposes, why has Tehran repeatedly failed to report its nuclear facilities, including those at Natanz and Arak, to the IAEA? Also, why does the Iranian government keep refusing to answer the IAEA's questions regarding a secret nuclear facility reportedly located in the suburbs of Tehran? Two nonpartisan organizations based in Washington, the Institute for Science and International Security and the Foundation for the Defense of Democracies, last year released a detailed report on Iran's clandestine nuclear activities at this site. In addition, why did the Iranian government place an S-300 anti-aircraft missile system at the Fordow underground nuclear site after the 2015 nuclear agreement? Finally, why does the Iranian regime never adequately address reports about its efforts to obtain illegal nuclear technology and equipment? Germany's domestic intelligence agency, the Federal Office for the Protection of the Constitution, revealed in its annual report for 2016 that the Iranian government had pursued a clandestine path to obtain illicit nuclear technology and equipment from German companies at what they quote, at what is even by international standards, a quantitatively high level. The truth is that from the perspective of the ruling clerics of Iran, obtaining nuclear weapons is a must to help Tehran advance its hegemonic ambitions to dominate the region. Also, by having nuclear weapons, the Iranian government can now more powerfully support the terror groups and proxies to destabilize the region without being concerned that the West might strike Iranian military targets. Most of all, in the view of the ruling clerics, having nuclear weapons can ensure the survival of the theocratic anti-American and anti-Semitic establishment. That is why, before it's too late, which it is fast becoming, it is incumbent upon the U.S. and the international community to take seriously Iran's nuclear advances and urgently address its rush to obtain nuclear weapons. Iran plays a pivotal part in the prophecy of Gog Magog, Ezekiel 38 and 39. Our next story, Attorney General Netanyahu not required to resign. Attorney General Avichai Mandelbrot said in a statement Monday that Benjamin Netanyahu can remain interim prime minister just days after serving him with charges of fraud, breach of trust, and bribery. The attorney general did not weigh in on whether Netanyahu could keep his other ministerial positions while under indictment. Netanyahu, Israel's longest-serving prime minister, has dismissed the charges as an attempted coup and refused to resign. He says he will fight the charges from the prime minister's office. Over the weekend, Netanyahu's main challenger within the Likud party, Gideon Sa'ar, told Channel 12 there isn't a single person who thinks that after a third or fourth or fifth or sixth election, Netanyahu will succeed in forming a government. Sa'ar demanded a snap primary to elect a party leader, which appears slated to be held within 6 weeks. Netanyahu's supporters immediately attacked Sa'ar, saying he has shown zero loyalty and maximum subversiveness. Netanyahu made no mention of his indictment during Sunday's cabinet meeting, talking about Iran, threats from Gaza, and domestic affairs. Later on Sunday, he traveled to Israel's northern frontier to tour the Golan Heights with military officials. Netanyahu issued fresh warnings to archenemy Iran after entrenchment in neighboring Syria. "We will also act to thwart Iran's attempts to turn Iraq and Yemen into bases for launching rockets and missiles against the state of Israel," Netanyahu said. The attorney general's decision to indict Netanyahu on fraud, breach of trust, and bribery charges Thursday shook up Israel's political system, which is in paralysis after inconclusive elections in April and September. It is the first time a sitting prime minister has been charged with a crime. With neither Netanyahu nor his main rival, former military chief Benny Gantz, able to secure a parliamentary majority, the country seems to be barreling towards its third election in under 12 months. Our next story, Iran is planning attacks on Israel, according to Benjamin Netanyahu. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu on Sunday accused Iran of planning attacks against Israel and said everything possible will be done to prevent them. The premier, who was indicted on corruption charges on Thursday and is seen to be battling for his political life, made his remarks on a visit to an army base near the border with conflict-ravaged Syria. "Iran's aggression in our region and against us continues," Netanyahu said. He was speaking on the day U.S. General Mark Milley, chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, was in the country to meet his Israeli counterpart, Aviv Kohavi. The two generals discussed operational questions and regional developments, an army statement said. Speaking on the Israeli annexed Golan Heights, Netanyahu said, "We are taking all necessary actions to prevent Iran from entrenching here in our region. This includes the activity necessary to thwart the transfer of lethal weaponry from Iran to Syria, whether by air or over land. We will also take action to thwart Iran's efforts to turn Iraq and Yemen into bases for launching rockets and missiles at Israel," he added. On Wednesday, in a rare confirmation of such operation, Israel said its warplanes carried out a very intense attack against Iranian forces and Syrian army targets in Syria. Britain-based monitoring group, the Syrian Observatory for Human Rights, said 23 people were killed in the strikes, 21 fighters and 2 civilians. The previous day, Israel's Iron Dome missile defense system had intercepted 4 rockets fired from Syria, with the army blaming an Iranian force. Attorney General Avichai Mandelbrot announced Thursday he had charged Netanyahu with bribery, fraud, and breach of trust, prompting speculation that the end of the premier's decade-long tender was nigh. Our next story, the charges against Benjamin Netanyahu explained. Until November 2019, no prime minister has ever been indicted while in office. The charges against Benjamin Netanyahu are serious: bribery, fraud, and breach of trust. The legal drama's collision with the Knesset's political deadlock and looming election raises the stakes even higher. Netanyahu insists he has committed no wrongdoing, and Israel, like other Western democracies, officially regards him as innocent until proven guilty. The unofficial court of public opinion is a different story, though. If the charges against Netanyahu are proven and he is found guilty, he stands to face as much as 10 years in prison on the bribery charges alone. Here's a reader's guide to the three separate investigations that led to the charges facing Netanyahu. Known as cases 1000, 2000, and 4000, the case numbers are how the Israeli police's Lahav 443 unit referred to the separate investigations as the allegations surface. Case 1000, entitled The Gifts Affair. The first of the three investigations began in December of 2016. From the outset, Israelis referred to as the Gifts Affair. Did Netanyahu use his power to help Arnon Milchan avoid paying taxes in Israel? The prime minister and his wife Sarah are suspected of receiving $200,000 worth of gifts from Hollywood mogul Arnon Milchan, an Israeli citizen. The Netanyahus and Milchan don't dispute that the entertainment tycoon provided crates of expensive champagne, cigars, and jewelry, characterizing them as gifts between friends. Nevertheless, Netanyahu is accused of using his influence to help Milchan obtain a visa to work in the U.S. Helping Milchan avoid paying taxes in Israel by widening the provisions of certain tax exemption laws targeting money laundering. Illicitly helping Milchan advance his interest in two Israeli TV channels, one of which Milchan partially owns. Netanyahu said he helped Milchan with his visa because of his contributions to Israeli security. Long before his Hollywood years, Milchan was reportedly recruited by Shimon Peres to engage in scientific espionage and procure military technology. The U.S. refused a request by Israeli investigators to question former Secretary of State John Kerry and Ambassador Daniel Shapiro about his visa. This may have been a factor in Attorney General Abihai Mandelbaum's decision not to indict Milchan. Case 2000, the Yediot Affair. Netanyahu is charged with striking a deal with Arnon Moses in order to receive favorable media coverage. The charges against Netanyahu in Case 2000 center around an alleged quid pro quo stuck between Netanyahu and Arnon Nani Moses, the publisher of the Yediot Aharonot Daily back in 2009. According to investigators, Netanyahu was also then Minister of Communication, was to support legislation that would ultimately weaken the rival daily Israel Hayom, which is distributed for free. In exchange, Yediot would provide more favorable coverage of Netanyahu in both the news and opinion sections. Legislation known as the Israeli Hayom Bill, outlawing the distribution of free daily newspapers of a certain size for 6 days a week, passed its first Knesset reading in 2014, but died in the next year when the Knesset dissolved itself and set early elections. Had the bill passed, Israel Hayom would have been forced to charge money or downsize. In October 2019, a recording of Netanyahu apparently negotiating with Moses was aired on Israeli TV. In it, Netanyahu appears to threaten to retaliate with all the tools at my disposal against negative or personal coverage. Among those also questioned by investigators were Sheldon Adelson, the billionaire casino magnate and Netanyahu supporter who owns Israel Hayom, Eitan Kabel, a labor Zionist union Knesset minister who originally sponsored the Israel Hayom bill. Netanyahu insists that nothing happened and that relations between the prime minister and the media shouldn't be criminalized. Moses was indicted along with Netanyahu. And then there's case 4000, the Bezek affair. The most serious charges against Netanyahu stem from the Bezek affair back when he also served as communications minister. Netanyahu is charged with giving media mogul Shaul Elovich regulatory benefits in exchange for favorable coverage. Netanyahu is suspected of having a quid pro quo with was Shaul Elovich Bezek's majority shareholder. Specifically, the prime minister is accused of giving the telecom regulatory benefits in exchange for favorable coverage on the Elovich-owned Walla News site. The benefits reportedly generated $500 million for Elovich. Specifically, Netanyahu is suspected of firing Communications Ministry Director General Avi Berger and replacing him with his former campaign manager, Shlomo Felber, to oversee policy favorable to Elovich. During his time in the Communications Ministry, Felber, among other things, approved Bezek's acquisition of a satellite TV company. He accepted Bezek's positions on certain telephone and internet technology reforms. They abolished requirements that Bezek maintained due to antitrust regulations, separate management and administration for its various subsidiaries. And they frequently shared classified ministerial documents with Bezek officials for their opinions. Felber told police that Netanyahu set the policy. The favorable coverage on Elovich's popular Walla News site is said to have been coordinated between Elovich's wife, Iris, and Netanyahu's former media advisor, Nir Hafetz. Chat messages on Hafetz's phone leaked to the Israeli media show Hafetz instructing Walla's then-editor, Ilan Yeshua, on coverage and weighing in on certain journalists being considered for a political correspondent's job. Both Felber and Hafetz have turned state witness. Shaul and Iris Elovich were indicted along with Netanyahu. Special thanks to honestreporting.com for this story. And that, my friends, is this week's edition of Revealing Prophecy. This program, along with Revealing the Bible, are only available after they air through the Biblical Truth Library. I want to encourage you to visit ignitinganation.com and sign up for our weekly newsletter and check out the Biblical Truth Library. Follow us online through Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel where you can catch up on over 1,400 interviews and never miss any of our great guests. Your comments and questions are always welcome, and we may include your answer in the next edition of the newsletter. Don't forget our regular live broadcast, our Monday through Friday, from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. Central Time. Until we see you right back here next week for the next edition of Revealing the Truth, we thank you for watching. We bid you shalom and happy Thanksgiving.